Hey guys, welcome back. My name is Michael McCarville. This is Fun with Fallen Flags, episode 69. This is the Dallas Divide series. So we're doing Dallas Divide in southwestern Colorado near Ridgeway. This is actually milepost 13 is where we're at as far if you're following along the main line of the Rio Grande Southern. This is a kit that's out of print, and it is a Banta Modelworks kit, and I want to thank Banta Modelworks for allowing me to feature their kits. Also, the Friends of Cumbres and Toltec. As I've said in the past, they're invaluable for researching, especially the Rio Grande Southern. There's so much material and photos and stuff that they have on their website that is fantastic for the modeler to use, or even just the rail fan. So I'm going to leave notes below so that we don't get bogged down too much. But for the both those two sites, as well as our YouTube channel, our Facebook group, and the Patreon site that's now up if you want to contribute to the cause. So let's go through what we're looking at. Typically, we're going to do Star Brand paints with an Iwata airbrush. It's a STR07 Rio Grande Southern Depot Buff for the wood sides, and then the trim is a STR33 for the Denver and Rio Grande Western trim brown color. We'll do a little bit of alcohol and India ink wash on the wood staining as far as the porch and the steps, and a little bit of red on the chimneys with some white mortar, but that's pretty much it. What's interesting about this kit is that it does have a front porch, which is cool, and then there's a lot of different roof lines on it, and different eaves and that type of thing. So we're going to jump right into the kit, and then if you have any questions, look in the notes below. I'm going to dump everything down there so you can refer to it as you need to. Okay, I always like to give you an idea of what's included in the kit so you kind of can brace yourself for if it's too much detail or if you're just really hungry for it. So let's go through the parts. This is the parts list, and you can see the three panels on the top. That's the exterior wood walls. The two panels below that, and those are the roof supports. And what those do basically reinforce the cardboard pieces for the roof so that you get the right angle as you glue them up. Below that is some window material, some roofing material, and then the stairs is that small little square of wood. Then moving to the right, you see there's a sheet of just window material and doors, some dimensional lumber, some chimney castings. Continuing on to the right is the two cardboard pieces for the roof sections, and then some tar paper. Now, this structure is going to be built as the prototype, but if you wanted to speed things up a little bit and not use the small, tedious shingle material that I'm going to use, it's included with it is the tar paper material. So that tissue paper material, cut it in strips, glue it on, and it's a tar paper roof. It'll go a lot faster if you do that, but I'm going to model it so that it matches the prototype building. So I'm not going to use the tar paper. However, on the shed, on the back roof, I wanted a little variety between the two types of roofing. So I did put the tar paper material on the roof on the shed. So, and it gives it kind of a cool visual contrast too. So what we have here is just a layout of the wall sections after you take them off those three sheets. What you have is the shed in the upper left, those three panels, and then the back wall is A5, and then the side walls and front wall. So I laid this out, just I like to kind of do this to kind of get a feel for the building as I'm starting to put it together, but it also maybe is helpful. Not all the information here on these parts is actually represented in the instructions, so this maybe helps you kind of lay it out. If not, then let's move on. So as you're putting the walls together, one of the things that it advises is to paint the interior a dark color. So I just shot it with some flat black, and I reinforced a couple of the wall sections. You'll notice a lot of 12 by 12 scale lumber that is inside the wall sections just to make sure they don't bend. I did find that the wall sections did bend a little bit, but since this whole thing is going to go on a plaster footer, it's going to kind of bring everything back into shape, even if it does bend. So it's not a huge deal, but I do like to reinforce the inside of the buildings. A lot of times I don't really do any detailing on the interiors. So if you are, then you might want to take that into consideration. However, I reinforce the heck out of this, so it's not going to warp or anything. Once it gets put on that plaster base, it's really not going to be an issue. So here you can see that I've got the interior walls that I'm continuing to glue those together. The framing square that sits on top of my self-healing cutting mat, I use that a lot. I use it in conjunction with triangles. And you can see them actually kind of propping things up with the triangle off to the right. And then the bottle of India ink in there is just kind of keeping the walls in the right shape as the glue all dries. At this point, it's a good idea just to test fit everything. Always test fit the wood panels as you're putting them together just to make sure everything looks good. But the true fit on this kit is putting the walls on top of the plaster base. I didn't have any issues. There is a point where the front door right there meets that short little wall. I had to splice in a little piece of wood in there just to make it a little more comfortable of a joint there. I don't know if that was just the way that mine ended up getting put together, or if that was something with the kit, but that might be something to keep an eye on. But whatever you have to do to get a nice solid square fit on top of that plaster cast base, there's two actually, there's the main one and there's the one underneath the shed. But anyway, you want to make sure that whole thing is ready to just fit nice and snug over it. And when I got mine done, it fit really well. So I was pretty happy with that. So I don't know if you can see this really well, but this is looking from the top down onto that joint. The front door gap is where that arrow is, and then that short wall is labeled right there. But you can see there's a piece of timber that I put in there that I wanted everything to kind of square up really well. So I did that, and that seemed to help it quite a bit. And something to keep an eye on if you're putting it together, but just test fit everything, and you may need to put a little spacer here and there. You may have to file a lot of the tabs down as well as you're putting it together just to make sure you get a nice square flush fit. But what you're looking at when you're gluing those panels together is the exterior, so you want to make sure that you keep that in mind if you're doing any kind of modifications. So after the structure got put together, I went and shot the whole thing with the Rio Grande Southern yellow. Now the fluorescent lights that I use in here, they are a little harsh when it comes to trying to capture the right color of the yellow that I'm using. This looks a lot more yellow than what it comes out to be, but I'll take some good photos at the end so you can get a good feel for what the yellow is. But anyway, the entire exterior got sprayed, even though I had already done the interior black, so there's a little bit of overspray, but I can touch that up with a brush if I need to. But it's going to be covered with a roof, and half the windows are going to be have shades and stuff on them, so there's not going to be much light that gets in there anyway. But just in case, if you want to go back and touch up that black, you can. I did, but after looking at it when it got put together, I'm not sure I really needed to, but it's done, so I'm not getting back inside it anytime soon, so that's done. So anyway, the yellow is painted, so let's move on. Okay, so after the yellow, I'm jumping ahead a couple of steps, but the corners are all covered, those tabbed joints where everything meets up. A lot like a lot of the other kits that we've already done, there is roughly, it's a 2x6 that is on each side of the wall, and that forms a corner, and you don't even see the tabs at all, so you just want to make sure they're nice and square. Now, when you put in those two 2x6s in place, you may have to remove a batten, the bump out on the siding. That's called a batten. You may have to trim that off so you can get a nice flush fit on those two corner trim pieces. And I painted all those brown before I put them on. And by the time I get completely done with the structure, I'll go around and do a few little touch-ups here and there. But essentially, I won't have to go and paint any of that stuff. So that's the trim pieces. You can see them on all the corners. Now, we're not putting the shed on right away. That comes much later in the kit. The shed is going to, the lean-to part of the building is going to come in towards the end. But we're going to put the doors on it and the windows on it. Now, you can build up the windows with the acetate window clear plastic piece, and then each of the layers of the windows, and then put those on. And then on the inside, if you want to, and I like to do this, put a little bit of glue in a few places on that window so that if for some reason somebody pushes on it or there's a derailment and something strikes the building, you know, just reinforce everything while you can, because once the roof's on and something happens, then it's going to be a pain to try to get in there. So you can see that the trim pieces are on. The windows and doors are on, and you also notice in the corners there are those little reinforcing triangles, and that keeps everything nice and square, so when you do try to put it over the base, you know, it's nice and snug when it goes on there. Now, one note about the doors. You see the front door that's next to the two windows, and then there's the short wall that has a door on it as well. Now, that opening for that door is not there. So what you need to do is you need to take the battens off and then cut an opening into it, unless you're just going to place it flush on that door from the outside. If you do that, you may want to add a little bit of trim, but I can tell you that I didn't cut a new opening for that, and I think it looks fine. There's going to be a porch and railing, or porch vertical supports on it. There's going to be a porch raised floor and stairs and stuff. So there's going to be a lot of other stuff in that corner. So I'm not too worried about the way it looks. But if you do have time to do it and you want to get it to have it have the same appearance as the front door, then that would be a good time to cut that opening. But I just glued mine onto the wall and it sat flush. So I think it looks fine. So I also painted the plaster castings for the two base pieces. I painted that black, but then on the outside I painted it just a kind of a neutral gray, which is fine because we're gonna put a lot of stuff over that gray. So, but when I painted the black, I did mask off all the black before I painted the gray over it, so you can see I'm peeling off the masking tape. So that it's still a black floor when the structure gets put on top of it. So this is what the flooring looks like when we're done. It's just painted black, but the gray has a wash over it. Now what I did is I spray painted the gray. I went over it with a little bit of different colors and put like some dark gray stones, and then I did some kind of tan colored stones, and then one of them was almost like came out like a pink, and I tried to go back and paint over that and it still looked a little pink, but by the time I got done weathering over it, I didn't even notice it at all. All you see is variation in the different colors of stones. And then this is what it looks like when the building is actually sitting on top of it, so you can kind of see that contrast. Now this whole corner right here is actually going to be a porch, so we're not really going to see any of this, but it gives you an idea of what that actually looks like when it's done. One other thing to do while we still have the structure interior accessible is to put the shades. Now, these shades, I tried to match the positions of the shades in the actual structure photos from the Friends of Cumbres and Toltec site, and you can see the two shades on the photo, the black and white photo on the top, they're about halfway down. Most of the windows, had, if they had shades on them, they were pulled about halfway down in the photo. So if you go with that, that's a good kind of rule of thumb. But even with that, I varied them just a little bit because they're not going to be everything exact. So the material is basically just a parchment type paper that I used from some of the other kits. And it's just parchment envelopes that I have had, and I've just cut them up. And it's just regular parchment paper. You can find it, you know, in any office supply store. They'll sell you a whole bunch of different kinds of it. It's just the right color for the actual shades. So I'll continue to use that, and it looks great when it's done. And then the chimneys. I don't know what it is about painting chimneys and brickwork, but I love doing it. And it may be because the Rio Grande Southern structures are almost all out of wood, that when I finally get a chance to paint something in brick and weather it and mortar lines and stuff, I get really excited. But I don't get to do it very often. So what you see here is the back chimney is a tall one, and then the chimney that sits at the very top of the sleeping quarter side, that one is the shorter one. So all I did was I basically painted it they're metal castings, so they're soft metal castings. So the first thing I did was prime them, let that dry overnight, then painted a red, and then washed it with a diluted white paint. And I then would dry brush the upper surfaces of that very carefully. Now, if you mess up and you get too much rust as you're doing the dry brush, you just put another layer of the white down, let it soak into the crevices again at the spot that you messed up, and then dry brush it again when it's dry. So it is important that you let all of it dry, because the paint will start to dissolve the layer underneath it, depending on what type of paint you're using. So you just want to make sure you have enough time in between coats so that it doesn't, that your white mortar and your red brick don't turn into pink, because it will. So so those are the chimneys, and I added a little bit of wash, and then I added, even on top of that, I added some chalk dust and Dullcoat on top of it. So that's essentially what they look like when they're done, and we just set those aside, and then we're going to continue on building the structure. So at this point, we've got the structure ready to go, and I have test fit the thing, and I'm happy with the wood. I set it down over it. I put glue around the inside, and I just rubber band the whole thing together and continue checking all the different sides to make sure the wood is snug all the way down to the plaster casting. The back pan, the back shed, the lean-to as well, the side walls tended to flare out a little bit as they got glued. I reinforced them. It still saw them kind of flare out a little bit. But once I got everything glued down to that plaster footer, it just tightened up, because then it was rubber banded in place and basically clamped in position. So then it was, once it was glued, it's not going to move. It's not going to change. You'll notice that there's a toothpick sticking in the back lean-to, the back shed. And all that's doing is keeping one of the walls so it's not tucked too far onto the plaster, so that it's helping it shape, keep its form, and retain its shape while the glue dries. And then once the glue's dry, I just pulled that out and then took all the rubber bands off. But that's all that toothpick is doing. It's sticking in there. It's a little bit of a spacer. I could have used a little block of wood to space it as well, but it just seemed to easy to, I'm always using toothpicks for all kinds of stuff. Okay, so when the structure's dry and the plaster footer is glued to the base, we glue the shed on the back to the wall, and then there's two more little triangles that we use to keep the shed in position. But at this point, you really need to be constantly fitting the roof sections and the shed so that you get the right position for everything. Now, the shed actually goes onto the back wall. The plaster, that's glued on the base, and the wood sections are glued onto the wall. But you have to wait until the roof section is in place so that you get everything lined up. Well, I just built the roof section, and I just made sure I knew where it was going to sit when it was done. And there's a lot of little fitting and trimming at this point with the roofs. The roof is actually kind of a tedious phase. I was waiting for everything just to be absolutely perfect. So this is the order I did it in. So the shed goes on the back, and then I put the roof to the shed with the trim on it on, and then I tar papered the roof, and I used that red oxide that you see here on the roof. That was an easy one-off. I glued that in place, so then I could start working on the other roof sections. The next step is to get the other two roof sections in place. So there's triangle A-frame pieces that go inside that help maintain that shape. You want to make sure that you have the openings for the fireplaces punched out, and the trim pieces on the ends. I put those on while it was flat just so that it was a little bit easier to work with than actually working with it on the structure. But once you get those two A-frames in place, you can continue to just set them in place and see which, you know, trim where you need to, get a good flush fit. I will tell you, this was a very tricky part because there's a lot of leeway where the one roof on the left can actually sit on top of the roof, but there's nothing really pointing the other roof. And you can see where I drew guidelines to where I wanted it to end up. And that gave me an idea of where I was going to actually have the roof sit. And then keep in mind, the shed's already on the back. So you're going to want to keep all that lined up. Okay, so let's talk about roofing materials. So the kit comes with the tar paper roof, so it would look like the roof, the red roof there. I still have so many shingles left over from an earlier Banta Modelworks kit that I'm still going through them. And what's nice about it is it gives it a nice consistent look to the structures that I have, but it's also very tedious. It's very time consuming. So if you're looking forward to putting this kit together and getting the tar paper roof, the guidelines are already on the roof. Just do that. However, I wanted to keep the consistent look, so I have the shingles. And even after roofing this structure, I still have shingles left over. And this is probably the third or fourth structure that I've done, all different sizes, still working through the inventory of that strip shingle material. And it's very time consuming to do this. So this is definitely not something that you want to do if you want to speed through this kit build, because it will definitely slow you down. When you do finally get done, then you have the two roof sections shingled with whatever material you're going to go ahead with. And then there's the front porch roof, which is glued on as well. That's another tricky fit. Just keep test fitting and make sure everything's nice and straight and square. Once those are all glued in place, you can pretty much walk away from the roof, except we have the caps to put on the roof where the shingle material comes. If you're using the tar paper material, you'll want to get a really thin strip of that, because they would have basically started from the bottom and put layer on layer all the way up the roof. And then when they got to the top where the two seams meet of the roofing material, they'd create a cap of the roofing material, whatever it happened to be. And then they would put a thin strip of that on top to hide the joint where the tar paper would come together or the shingles would come together. So that's what I've done. And you really want to take your time with that step, because it'll really look, it'll really be apparent if you don't have a good, solid, nice, straight line on that. So take the extra time to make sure. What I do is I take that whatever roofing material I'm using, and then I take a metal straight edge. I use the actual HO scale ruler that I have, and I basically take the material, I draw a line down it, I cut it, I draw a line down it, and then I put the scale rule in this very center of it, and then I fold it up against the around the scale rule, and then get a nice solid even straight crease, and then at that point you're good to glue it on. So at this point the roof is done. We need to color it, and we also need to finish the front porch and then the steps. So the steps go on the very back door and on the very front of the porch, and then so now we need to build the porch. So the porch is essentially just a rectangular box frame with legs. They're 18 inches, worked out really well on my kit. 18 inches in HO scale, and that comes out to the right height that it meshes well with the laser cut stairs. There's two, one for the front door, one for the back door. Planks on the top, stained with alcohol and India ink with a little bit of oil-based paint wash just to give it a little bit, a hint of a brownish color, but we still want it to look pretty faded. So this gets glued on the front, and then after that, we have the vertical supports for the roof. So we're going to cut those next and place those on the porch that we have, and then that's going to be it for the front door. Okay, so the front porch is done. This phase is a little more tricky than it looks, because it's not just gluing up five vertical support beams and then a cross beam across the top of it. You have to space everything out, but the roof's at an angle and the beam that's going to sit underneath it is kind of it could be at an angle if you clamp it to that roof. So you just kind of have to build the whole thing one piece at a time, work your way around, figure out how tall the posts need to be, and then cut them all the same length. That way you know everything's going to be nice and flat. So it's basically a cross beam, four posts across the front, a back one, and then a little cross brace that's in there. One other thing I did was I put an extra board on the very bottom of the porch, because the prototype deck actually looks like that. So that's it. Let's take a look at the backside and then the chimneys. Okay, so the back step is in place. Now, if you glue the step up against the that plaster casting piece on the shed, what you'll find is there's a huge drop between the bottom of the door. So all I did was I took some extra 12-inch by 12-inch dimensional lumber, and I built a little deck for that thing to come out on. You could make that deck bigger if you wanted to, especially if you like to look at it, but I just decided I was going to use some extra railroad lumber that was probably sitting around, and they built that up, and then they put the steps in place. So looks a little bit better. There's not a huge drop. I probably could have built it up a little bit further. You could do a whole deck back there if you wanted to, but as far as what I expect the backside of it to look like, and there's no photos for that, it would probably be something close to this. So anyway, that's what the backside looks like. Now let's take a quick peek at the chimneys. Okay, so both chimneys are in place. When you're gluing them in, it's a really good idea to use an angle, something that you can kind of line it up with so that you can place the building away from you a little bit, and then use the triangle and make sure that the chimney is actually protruding out of the top perpendicular and both angles, you know, both directions. So just keep checking everything. I use Walther's glue on this to glue these in place. Now, I don't remember if I had mentioned this previously, but one of the things I did is I put a piece of basswood of scrap into the opening, so from the underside. So if I push the chimney all the way through, it wouldn't drop, and then it would be lost forever because I wouldn't be able to retrieve it unless I carved open the building. So anyway, both of those have pieces of basswood underneath them as a safety net. So when I get around to putting the Walther's glue and attaching them that way, all I really have to do is put the Walther's glue on those basswood pieces that are in place, put the chimneys in, and then when the Walther's goo and the chimney hit and they start to, you know, expand and you know, get all gooey and messy and stuff, that's happening inside the structure. I don't have to worry about it flowing up and out of the structure itself. So at this point, let's take a look at the final shot for the constructed building. Back a little bit. Now that's the front. And I did weather the roof a little bit just for some staining, especially down from the chimneys. And I still have a little bit of a shine, a little bit of a sheen on that roof. And I've hit it with Dullcoat a couple of times. But I also weathered it with a couple different colors of chalk too, including a rust color, because when I got the paint dried, it dried a little more brown than I wanted. And I wanted to bring the red hues up a little bit. So all I did was put some chalk powders on it with a kind of a rust color and then brush it, streak it all down, take the brush, start at the top and just streak everything from the top to the bottom, just like the water and weathering and stuff would cause it. And it brought the red up on the roof a little bit. So I'm pretty happy with it. I think the rock foundation looks fantastic. I like the contrast of colors. There's a lot of different hues going on in there. And hey, let's take a look at the back so you can kind of get a better feel for that. So, all right, that's what the back looks like. You see the deck in place, the little beams and stuff on there. I like it. If I were to do this kit again, I would probably lower the door, even though I'd have to patch the board and batten siding on the top. That would probably make the stairs work out a little bit better. I also probably wouldn't use the stairs quite as wide as they are now, but I just decided to go with what was in the kit and not modify that. I know that's unusual for me. I like to modify stuff, but just for what, considering it's probably not going to get seen when I put this on next to the tracks, it's probably just going to get the front view and that's it. The backside may never be seen. So. But I'm pretty happy with it, even if it is seen. Now, I also like the two kinds of roofing. The tar paper is what you're going to get on the whole kit if you build it with the stuff that's in it. But so you can see the shed, the whole roof would look like that. However, I took the tedious route and went with the two kinds. So I like the way it looks. It looks like the shed, the lean-to structure, was added at some point in later, but it may have been built at the same time. There's not a ton of data on this, and there's really not a lot of good photos on it either. I've shown you the couple of good photos that exist so far in this series. So anyway, that's it for this kit build. I'm on to the next one. I've got a couple different series going on, so I'm building stuff for the Dallas Divide series, plus ochre, plus Vance Junction, and I actually got another kit for another series as well, and I'm not going to tell you about that one yet because that one's kind of cool, but I've got enough stuff going on right now that I don't really need to add something else. So that's it for me. Again, my name is Michael McCarville. There's stuff in the notes below if you want to look at any of the links, or even my website, or the YouTube channel, or the Facebook group, or the Patreon group. There's all kinds of stuff in there. I left notes in there for the colors that were used. And that's it. I will see you guys on the next episode. And thanks for watching. Take care.